Okay, well, students, we are in this chapter of lasers, and we have more or less discussed a lot of things about the working of a laser. We have talked about the Einstein's theory of stimulated emissions, wherein we saw the necessity of population inversion. Then we saw how population inversion is achieved through the process of pumping, either through 3-level and 4-level. We saw that the 4-level is better. We also saw why a metastable state is required for process of light amplification. Now, one important last component of a laser system is what is called as an optical resonator. Okay, every laser system you will find this component or device called as optical resonator. So what is this optical resonator? Okay, so before we go into the details about what the optical resonator is, we'll try to understand why we require the optical resonator. Then automatically we will understand what is this optical resonator. So we know that light amplification takes place in this active medium. It is a medium in which the atoms are in the excited state. They have been taken into a state of population inversion. So we'll assume that in this active medium, most of the atoms through the process of pumping have already been taken into the state of population inversion. Now, so they are in the excited state. They are waiting for photons to collide with them and force them to come down and produce stimulated emissions and give rise to laser. So we know that the first photon comes through spontaneous emission. This photon goes and collides, might be with one excited state atom over here, forces it to come down and gives rise to two photons. Now these two photons are traveling in the same direction as the incident photon. So we'll assume that the incident photon is in this horizontal direction from left to right. So the two stimulated emitted photons which are given out are also in the same direction. Now these two, they will travel through the medium, and as they travel they might meet two more excited atoms in their path, force them to come down and give rise to four identical photons, again traveling in the same direction, that is horizontal from left to right. Now these four, as they're traveling through the medium, they may meet with four more atoms, force them to come down and give rise to eight identical photons. Then by the time it reaches eight, we'll assume that we have reached the end of the medium. Remember, this medium, active medium, is not an infinitely long medium. It is just a finite material. It has a certain length. For example, in the ruby laser, the active medium is a ruby rod about 5 centimeters in length. So it has a finite length. So when the photons reach the end of the medium, now, if the photons are allowed to come out of the medium, no more further light amplification will take place. This 8 will not become 16, because once they come out outside the medium, there are no atoms in the excited state. So light can be amplified only inside the medium, not outside it. So somehow, if you allow the photons to come out, then the process will stop at 8 only. 8 will not become 16, 32 and huge number. So if you want the process to continue, now remember, in this medium, all the atoms have not been de-excited. There are still huge number of atoms remaining in the excited state. But only thing, the photons have to go and strike them. But then the photons are coming out. So we have to not allow this all the photons to come out. We have to put them back into the medium. So how can we put them back into the medium? So what we're going to place over here is, we are going to place a mirror. We're going to place a plane mirror. So what this mirror will do? Whatever photons come out, it will reflect them back inside the medium. So then the photons will be now traveling in the opposite direction. They will meet excited atoms in their path, force them to come down. 8 will become 16, then 32, then 64. And let us say by the time it reaches 64, we reach the other end. So now all the photons are traveling in horizontal direction from right to left. Okay. So now again we have reached the end of the medium. Now if the 64 photons are allowed to come out, then once they come out, no more further light amplification will take place. So the process will stop at 64. So if you want the process to continue, then the 64 photons have to be put back inside the medium. So what we do? We place another plane mirror over here. So another plane mirror. So what this mirror will do? Whatever 64 photons comes out, it will put them back inside. So these 64 photons will be traveling again now horizontally from left to right. We'll meet 64 excited atoms in their path, force them to come down, making it number of photons will become 128, then 256, then 500. Again, they will try to come out, but this mirror will again put them back inside. So this process will continue, and we'll be getting a huge number of millions of identical photons traveling in the identical photons having the same energy, same phase. So that will be laser. Okay. So what is the optical resonator? Therefore, they are just a arrangement of two plane parallel mirrors to plane parallel mirrors, as seen in this diagram here, with the active medium in between them, what is the purpose of this optical resonator? What is the purpose of these mirrors? It is to provide, the first requirement of the optical resonator is to provide feedback of photons back into the medium, back into the active medium, so that the process of light amplification will continue. Now, one of these mirrors is 50% reflecting, while the other mirror is 100% reflecting. Why is it like that? Why are both not fully reflecting mirrors? Why is one 100%? Why is one 50%? Now, if both were 100%, what would have happened? All the photons would have just kept on reflecting back and forth. They would have increased in number, no doubt. But then there would be nothing coming out of the system. There would have been no laser output. So what is the use of a laser if there is no photons coming out, no laser output? So there has to be some photons coming out. So that's why this mirror is made 50% reflecting. So that 50% of the photons which are falling on this mirror will come out and give you the laser output. Well, the remaining 50% will be reflected back inside, and these which are reflected back inside will continue the process of light amplification. They will cause more stimulated emissions to take place in the medium. This side, we don't require laser output from both ends. We require laser output only from one end. So this side mirror is 100%. So whatever photons are falling on this, entire 100% photons will be reflected back inside, so that the process of light amplification will continue. Okay, so that is the optical resonator. It is a system of two plane parallel mirrors with the active medium between them, such that one mirror is 50% reflecting, other is 100% reflecting. Now, so first requirement of the optical resonator, these mirrors, is to provide feedback. But there is one more important reason why the optical resonator is required, and that you will understand from this thing. Now, we know that laser occurs through the first photon which is required for the laser to start, occurs through spontaneous emission. Now, remember, spontaneous emission is a random process. So different spontaneously emitted photons will give rise, will be emitting photons in different phases, different directions. So let us say this is one spontaneously emitted photon. It will give rise to two photons, stimulated emitted photons in this direction. Let us say one more spontaneous, remember, only one spontaneously emitted photon will not be emitted. There will be many spontaneously emitted photons which are emitted, because in this system there are billions and millions of atoms. So out of all these atoms, many of them will be undergoing spontaneous emissions. So in this figure, I have shown you three such spontaneously emitted photons, all in different directions. So each different spontaneously emitted photon will start small lasers, all in different directions with different phases, different directions. So this one is in this two. Another spontaneously emitted photon might be emitted in this direction. It will give rise to a chain of photons, 2, then 4, and 8, and so on, in this direction. Another spontaneously emitted photon might be emitted in this direction. It will give rise to 2, then 4, and 8, and so on, in this direction. So what is the result of all this thing? Therefore, imagine there were 1,000 such spontaneously emitted photons, and all were in different directions. It would have given rise to small chains of lasers, all in different directions. So that is all jumbled. That is all that is incoherent light. That will not provide directional light as seen in a laser. So we must somehow, what we must do, we must not allow all these laser directions. We must allow only one laser direction and remove the unwanted other directions. So that again is done by the optical resonator mirrors. So these two mirrors, if you see the mirrors, they are exactly parallel to each other, and they are perpendicular to the axis of the optical of the active medium. So which photons will be reflected back and forth many times without coming out of the system are the ones photons which are traveling exactly horizontally along the axis of the medium, perpendicular to the mirrors. These photons which are traveling at an angle, or this one which is traveling at this side, they will not be reflected by the mirror, or these ones will undergo reflection, but then they will come out from the sides. Sides, top side and bottom side, there are no mirrors there. So whatever photons come out from the side, they will be lost. So only these photons which are traveling horizontally, they will travel back, forth, and they only will keep on increasing in number. The other photons which are in different other direction other than horizontal, they will might be reflect one or two times, but then surely they will come out from the sides of the medium, and they will be lost, and they will not be further amplified. So only these photons will be there. So therefore, the second reason why the optical resonator is there is that they allow only photons traveling in a certain direction. What direction? the horizontal direction, exactly perpendicular to the mirrors. Only these photons will be amplified, while the other direction will be removed. So therefore, we'll get a highly directional beam of photons traveling only in one direction. So that is a laser. Now, one more thing about this laser is there's something called as longitudinal cavity modes. Now, in this optical resonator, can these mirrors be any distance apart? The distance between the mirrors, can it be anything, or is there a fixed value which this should be there? The distance between the two mirrors L must be a fixed value. Why? Because now all this time we have considered light as a particle. But remember, light is also a wave. So wave properties of light require that when a wave is traveling back and forth between two mirrors, they must form a standing wave. So in other words, the wave goes this way, falls this way, and then this way, and this way it reflects back between the mirrors, such that a standing wave will be formed. Now, a standing wave will be formed between these two mirrors only when the distance between the mirrors is an integral multiple of half wavelength. Okay, so in other words, L must be equal to m times lambda by 2, okay, where m is an integral number. So only when this condition is satisfied, a standing wave will be formed between these two waves. So therefore, light will be amplified between these two mirrors. The wave properties of light require that the distance between the two mirrors must be m lambda by 2, so that a standing wave is formed between them. So m is called a modal number. Now here we can replace this lambda with frequency, because by the formula lambda is wavelength is velocity of light divided by frequency. So therefore lambda will be c by nu, and then from that form we can obtain the formula frequency nu m is equal to mc by 2l. So this nu m is called as the modal frequency, okay, and m, as I told you, is called as a modal number. So for different values of m, we will get different modes of vibration. For example, if a ray goes from this way to this way and only one loop is formed, one loop of standing wave is formed, then it's called a primary mode. M is 1. So therefore m will be lambda by 2, half the wavelength. If two loops are formed like this, 1 and then 2, so two loops are formed, then it's called a secondary mode of vibration. In that case, m is 2. If three loops are formed, 1, 2 and 3, between the two mirrors, three loops are formed, then m is 3, and so it's called a tertiary mode of vibration. Like that, for different values of m, you get different modes, different configurations of loops between the two mirrors. So these are called as longitudinal cavity modes, because like the gap between the two mirrors is like a cavity. Okay, so that's why whatever light waves are vibrating between the two mirrors, they are called as cavity modes. Okay, so for different values of m, we'll get different modes of vibration. M is equal to 1 is primary mode, m is equal to 2 is secondary mode, 2 loops, m is equal to 3 will be forming 3 loops, it's called a tertiary mode, and so on. Thank you.